Good evening and welcome to a new edition of Daily Debate. Today, Egypt marks the sixth anniversary of the January 25th revolution. At this time, a lot of questions raise themselves, and most importantly, what have we achieved? And what do we need to achieve, taking into account that when people hit the streets on that day, they had a certain vision for the new Egypt. With us this evening to discuss this issue is engineer Hassan Chaben, former vice chairman of El Wefd Party. A pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you for inviting me.
With us also this evening is Dr. Mustafa Rida, professor of economics at the American University here in Cairo. A pleasure to have you with us. We had a vision on January 25th. And I don't think the vision changed that much in June 30th, except maybe June 30th people went out against the regime itself, which they felt was not going to achieve this vision. But if we say division, do you think we are working towards attaining this vision, or are we moving in a different direction? The floor is open, whoever wants to start the discussion. It's a democratic
one. Yes, that one.
I think we've lost vision. I think the people of Egypt, actually, when they went out on whether in the 25th of January or the 30th of June, we had a vision. And we wanted to share and we wanted to contribute. But I think in the first event, which is the 25th of January, though it was a revolution and it was a real revolution, but it does not have a head.
And can you have a revolution without a head?
No.
And because this is a conflict, by the way. Yeah, this is what a lot of people are.
He was praising the fact that we, you know, there is no leaders for the revolution, as if it was something good or an advantage or something like that. But I think because the revolution did not have a head, it lost vision and it lost direction. And we actually, gradually, the revolution was stolen by others, and the Muslim Brotherhood surfed on the wave, and they managed to reach the presidential chair, which was completely not what the people of Egypt aimed for. It was complete. It was a big disappointment, actually. The 30th of June was a corrective revolution, actually. We corrected the mistake that took place, and we got out the Muslim Brotherhood out of the presidential palace, and we elected a president who can defend Egypt, because actually Egypt is in a state of war, actually.
Yes.
And whether we like it or not, actually we have to admit that we are in a state of war. When we actually started the revolution, we did not have these challenges. But today, Egypt is facing a different battle, economical war, as well as a war against terrorism. The environment, the reasons, the causes, everything is completely different. And I think the Egyptian people actually lost some of their steam. The momentum is no longer there. So I think we did not accomplish much.
Okay. Dr. Mustafa Rida, how do you see it?
Well, actually, I'd like to add what just was mentioned just now. I'd like to agree with what you mentioned just now, and I'd like to add to it something very, very important. That according to what we know about change, managing change, change takes a long time. However, the point is that people thought then, when we had this revolution, that by the election of a new president, that he would be having the magic wand, and they had very high expectations that things are going to change very quickly in a dramatic way, you see, to the best. Certainly, these, you see, when we discuss objectives, you see, we always say in management that objectives have to be realistic, you see. It is unrealistic that any president, it's not, I'm not talking about the former, the one which is Mr. Abdel Fattah Sisi, anyone who is occupying this position wouldn't be able to change and to see all the problems that have been over in the country since 65 years ago. You know, we have been in
an accumulation of problems. Yes.
So certainly it would be unrealistic that we would expect a dramatic change in a short time span. Mm. And this was, this is the problem. The people thought then when they elected Mr. Sisi that he would be having the magic wand.
And he would change things overnight.
And yes, automatically. And certainly this is an unrealistic objective. Again, I would like to blame probably the media and the mass communication that they didn't, there's a vacuum between the people and probably the government and the administration. They should have clearly set up that these are the problems and these are how we're going to solve this. There should be a participation, you see, between the people and the government.
I'm not standing in defense of the media here, because the media, I agree with you, and we're in that profession, and we did commit a lot of mistakes, and maybe raising people's expectations,
yes,
and making people focus not on the important stuff for a while.
Right.
But is it only the media, or is it the people that go out and talk to the people? Because really, you had a lot of analysts, commentators, even officials.
I agree with you.
That raised people's hope. They were not transparent enough to draw the correct picture. Or am I?
I agree with you 100%. I was about to say that. I'm not blaming only the media.
Yes.
When I'm talking about the media, I'm not talking about television only. I'm talking about the newspapers, all communication devices, you see, all various communication devices,
yes,
you see.
Yes.
And certainly, a lot of people, you see, sometimes they talk in an unprofessional manner, you see. Mm. So, and they, unfortunately, the people here believe anything, you see, especially the people which are, don't have a culture and don't have a certain level of education. So they believe anything and they act upon it, you see. Mm. And this, in management, you call it the self-fulfilling prophecy. You see, it goes that if there's a rumor that spreads out, it turns to be a reality, and then people act upon it, you see. Mm. So this is the real problem, you know. Number three is that really people got a disillusion, you see, because they got disappointment. Specifically, I'd like to talk about the latest events about liberalization of the Egyptian pound and also removing certain subsidies.
The reduction of subsidies.
This was a good, you see, a good step, but there are other, you see, it's a comprehensive program that the government, unfortunately, didn't do their homework in a professional manner, you see. They should have protected the people which limited income, like the pensioners, like the people which working in the government, you see, all these have been affected, because there's a great deal of dissatisfaction now, because the whole program, you see, it's as if you have a sick person and you gave him a certain diagnosis and a certain medicine, but you didn't follow up with him that the treatment should be continued, you see. Mm. So there's something missing in the puzzle here. And unfortunately, still people, I've been asking a lot of people, you see, and they don't know, as if I'm a normal citizen, there's a great deal of dissatisfaction about these price increases, you see.
Mm.
And people are suffering. But let us hope that things are going to change on the long run. But people don't have patience. That's the point.
Can we take, individual things? Egypt was a country, as we were saying, these are accumulation of policies that are over 60 years.
Right.
If we take into account that we reached a stage whereby we import over 80% of what we really need, we destroyed our industrial sector to a certain degree, our competitive edge in the industrial sector.
Right.
We destroyed the agricultural sector to a certain extent. How long would it take, and I'm talking here maybe especially the agricultural sector, which is really your mm-hmm. expertise, which is the food.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a saying in Arabic, if you cannot feed yourself, then you cannot have a decision, or you cannot control yourself, really. How long would it take for us that we can have this agricultural revolution whereby we turn from a 99% import-oriented country to, I don't want to say just export, but at least to reach a stage whereby we're self-sufficient in the strategic agricultural commodities?
This is a long story, but I'm going to try to be as brief as possible.
Please.
Actually, the whole thing started in the early or mid-70s. In the mid-70s, when we had this open door policy that President Anwar Sadat started, we did not really have a master plan. And it was a big chaos, and it continued, actually. It developed a lot of businessmen who were very rich later on and monopolized a lot of chances, and the development chances did not infiltrate to the mass. It was actually monopolized by a group of people that later on formed an ally with President Hosni Mubarak and the ruling system after President Sadat. But we chose the easy way. We started to sell companies and factories that could have actually, if we had an ambitious plan and develop these companies and these factories, we could have actually achieved better results than selling them and just getting a return to, you know, just block a gap in our economy. That was a very good solution to sell. Selling was an easy way out of the problem. It was never a solution for our problems. We are facing a very similar situation today. Let me illustrate on this for a second. Suddenly, after we liberated the pound, the national banks announced a 20% interest on the pound. And now most of the liquidity in the market went into these banks. The banks are stuffed with currency. And nobody actually in the right mind will just go to the banks and get a loan for 25% interest, for instance, because it doesn't make sense that I get a loan for that much, how much profit I'm going to make, what is my overheads, all of that would get me out of the competition circle. So we need the ministers who are working in isolation, like the Minister of Industry, the Minister of Agriculture, the Minister of Finance. All of these people should coordinate, because the banks should change the philosophy of investment. They need to form nuclears to study a number of companies that the Minister of Industry should present a list of. These companies that they can, if they improve their production, they will block a big percentage of what we import from outside and depletes our dollars. So the Minister of Industry should come up with a list, say, for about 400 or 500 companies. If we inject liquidity in these companies, they will be able to improve their production, the quality, specifications, maybe export some of their production, cover a lot of our needs. So we need coordination between the different ministers. Each minister is acting on his own. We need to coordinate. We need a maestro. And we need objectives. We need results. We have existing on the ground, actually, factories and companies who are not operational. We could actually give instructions to the banks, inject money, and not as a loan, get into these companies as temporary partners for a number of years till you recover what you've injected, and take another 2-3 years later on to get back your profits. It's the Talat Harb spirit. We need to invest in our economy. We are asking foreigners to come and invest in Egypt. Yes, but we have to set the example that our country is stable. We have a huge market. We have 90 million consumers. We need to invest this market. We need to invest the existing assets that we have. We have a good number of assets that if we could improve their financial conditions, we could save a lot of our hard currency, which is the dollar in our case, and try to improve the situation, because we are depending on tourism. It's
a volatile market.
Right. So actually, we need to establish things on the ground.
Yes.
We need to invest our population. We need to invest what we have, our assets.
If we talk about infrastructure and energy, for example, okay. 3 years ago, we had time slots, all of us, whereby you would have a power cut, for example. Right. Now we're talking about Egypt reaching a stage where not only is it self-sufficient, but maybe in a couple of years we will be exporting sources of energy. How do you think we progressed on that and on the infrastructure? Lots of roads and things which really work towards attracting investment, because if you don't have proper infrastructure and energy, definitely, then you really can't have any investors.
Okay, before I answer your question, I'd like to mention a very, very important point, adding to just what mentioned now. And I totally agree about what was said now. However, I would like to add two very important points.
Go ahead.
That are considered blocks, you see, or bottlenecks in order to for the economic advancement. First one is the legal system has to be revamped, because I cannot expect an investor to come here and stay and go to court and stay in his verdict for 15 to 20 years, you see. Not everyone can afford arbitration. Arbitration is only done through oil companies, because they have a lot of money and it's very costly and very expensive. So no one can afford arbitration. So we have to revamp the legal system first. Yeah. And I think the president, since 10 days ago, has mentioned that, you see. He said, we have to revamp our system, our legal system, because our procedures are very, very bad. Number two, which is a disaster also, is the 6 million employees, governmental employees,
definitely,
which
yes,
are not working, you see. And the productivity is 27 minutes per day, you see. Another thing also, they're not properly trained, and they're used to a certain methodology, you see. And I cannot blame them, because they were brought up in such an environment. No one
and
trained them.
And this has
them.
To be changed.
So all this has to be changed, you see. Mm. We cannot afford having people coming from abroad, or even Egyptians, having blocks with permits, or probably the infrastructure, the electricity not going to the factory, you see. The sewage system is not working, you see. It's a sort of... You see, as you just mentioned now, the coordination between ministers, you see. Yeah. Again, I am very much astonished that they still, the government is adopting a classical approach. They changed the investment law. It's not the investment. We have a lot of laws, you see. It's the application of the laws. It's the spirit of the law. It's how we're going to have these people work in a professional manner. Mm-hmm. It's how to train them. We have to upgrade our human resources. Our human resources, unfortunately, are far beyond, I'm talking about the majority, you see. They are far beyond the job requirements. I'd like to tell you a very important issue, that a lot of businessmen could not find professional people. It's extremely difficult to find an employee. Yeah, very, very difficult to find someone. About the gas and your question now, I'm answering your question, which is very, very important. Certainly, there have been a drastic improvement in the energy situation. And certainly this will have a positive impact, but still the energy is not enough and the roads are not enough. As I mentioned, we have to have, it's the people. We have to know how to manage our proper human resources.
When you say the energy is not enough, what do you mean by it's not enough?
I mean, we have other very, very important that are considered the driving force.
Yes,
for,
but when you say it's not enough, and we just want to clarify that it's not the source
the
of
source.
Energy not enough. You're
yes.
saying that this does not, you need more ingredients.
Exactly.
Okay,
yes,
just
yes.
so that we...
Yes,
I would like to add something to what Dr. Mustafa just said. Indeed, we've solved the problem, and we really appreciate this. There is a big investment in this sector, but we have to put in mind that our neighbors in the north have a very ambitious program that by the year 2030, they will not use nuclear power, and they will use...
All renewable.
Renewable.
This is the trend.
Wind and solar. And we are the country that actually
can export that.
Suitable for exporting solar energy
and wind
to
energy.
Europe.
Yes.
So actually, I think the government will have to consider forming giant companies financed by just the people of Egypt to establish a giant company to sell and produce solar energy. Our friends in Europe actually have signed agreements with countries in Africa, like Senegal, Burkina Faso. You know, all of these countries have agreements with Europe to export solar energy to them.
Yes.
I don't know why we did not join this group. We have our desert is a huge mirror, and we
Definitely.
Could actually benefit from that. So far, I see that we're lagging behind. I think we need to stop investing in regular and traditional
sources of
energy. Mm-hmm. And we need really to be aggressive and take the decision that solar is our aim. To produce even the equipment and the devices, the cells and everything.
Yeah.
We have the sand. We export the sand to others
right.
to produce the cells. It's ironic. We need really to be serious. We need to get the know-how. And, you know, Chinese could help us in this respect. They're advanced in this. I want to say that even our neighbors, the Israelis, are very advanced in the solar energy. We need really to benefit from what we've signed. We've signed a lot of agreements. We need to put it to work, actually. That's it. So I think we need to stop and start immediately in the new types of energy, the renewable energies.
What else do you think we need to move forward in a constructive fashion?
I think also reducing unnecessary expenditure, government expenditure, which is really not rationalized. You see, in public finance, you see, there are certain ways that you can rationalize public expenditure and direct them to productive sides. Unfortunately, until now, we didn't see positive sides from the government in order to rationalize public expenditure. I'll give an example here. In the television, I was just down there, you see, I asked one of the drivers here, he told me we have 60 cars which are junk cars and we didn't take an action in order to sell these cars. You see, these cars occupy space, number two, these are considered idle capital. Number three, they could get a revenue for the television, you see. So he told me the procedures, I told him, why didn't you sell them? You know, he told me because the procedures here are very lengthy. And this is one, I just did this before coming here, you see, I was just down there and I found a lot of junk cars, so I asked him, what are these cars doing? So he told me this story. This is an example, you see, from one of, I think, thousands of items that we could rationalize our expenditure. We could also optimize the use, as we just mentioned now, of our capital expenditure and capital investments, you see. The public sector, which was privatized, it was not, the privatization program is right, but was not applied in a professional manner, you see. The way it was done, it was wrong, you know. This is a very big subject, because if we're going to talk about it, we're going to spend
But the privatization problem, it's a program, it was applied since January 25th? Or this is a
long time ago, in 2000.
You need 2000. To re-evaluate the privatization program.
I think what Dr. Mustafa said, we need to apply austerity measures on governmental expenditure. They have to set the example for austerity.
Right.
I mean, all this spending is on this luxurious way of running things. Egypt is a management problem.
Right.
Egypt is a management problem, and we need to admit that, and we need to deal with that. I would like to say that we need to think in a different way in solving our problems.
Meaning.
We have a sugar problem. The source of sugar was two things in Egypt, the sugar cane and the
Beetroot. But the main source is sugarcane because of the because of the temperature.
So actually, I know for sure that the Ministry of Agriculture have started a long time ago an experiment to try to grow a plant that could produce the amount of sweetness in that particular plant, which we got it from Uruguay in South America, is 300 times sweeter than sugarcane. So for every fadan, we grow this plant with the name of this
plant. And this can be grown in Egypt. The temperature is
actually suited. Actually, we are in climate zone 9 and 10, similar to what even it gave better results than the Uruguay. And the home country of this plant requested to export this plant to them. So if we actually grow in this 1.5 million fadan, 200,000 fadans of this particular plant, and get Uruguay to put a factory with the technology that can produce sugar from this plant, we could export to them and still cover all our needs. The stevia, the name of the plant is stevia.
And the health effects of this plant?
It's they use it in South America as a drink. You know, they it's a very common thing in South America. Mm. So actually, we need to be aggressive. We need to take the initiative. All the traditional methods of solving our problems will not work out. We actually exceeded. We have very chronic problems. Unless we have a very aggressive way to face these problems, we will not be able to solve it in due time.
Mm-hmm. Gentlemen, one of the things that, if I was a foreign investor watching the show now, and I would ask myself, is that this country seems to be really not getting its act together enough for me to come and invest.
Let me add one thing, if you don't mind, before we move to your question.
Because we have a time frame.
Okay, it's 1 minute only. Last week in the breakfast show, I came here and was asked about the minister reshuffling. You see, they're going to change the cabinet. I said this is a very classic approach. You see, it's not the ministers that are in fault. You see, you have to change the whole system. You have to think out of the box. This is a very, very classic approach when something occurs, you see, lack of performance in a certain area occurs, we change it. This is not acceptable.
But sometimes it's because the person is not qualified. In some instances, the minister or the government official is not qualified enough to do the
job.
So
that's the point, you see, I wanted to mention. We still adopt classical approaches in solving. We don't think out of the box.
Okay. Why would an investor come?
I would like to add one little thing to what Dr. Mustafa just said. Actually, we're about to sell the box, not to think outside the box. We are about to sell the box. I think our national television could sign a protocol with the Ministry of Education and start really giving classes to students on air and attract the young people of Egypt to watch television and eliminate the cost that the Egyptian families are exposed to right now, the private classes outside the schools. We need to utilize all our
But we do resources. Have channels like that.
Yeah.
But we
there
need,
are
we
education
need to,
channels.
To, we need to invest in this actually more and more because actually we need to make the people in Egypt feel that we are aware of their problems and we are trying to solve their problems and improve the quality of education.
Well, yeah, the whole educational system needs
to be revamped.
Evaluation. Yeah, yeah. Now, I'll come to ask before we wrap up, why should an investor come? Because right now we are asking people to come and invest in Egypt. And we're not asking the foreigners, but even Egyptians living abroad, Egyptians here, to invest in their country. Why should they come?
I don't think anyone is going to come, unfortunately, for one reason. Because still, you see, the vision is not clear. We don't have a vision and mission statement, you see, until now. Decisions are taken and then reversed immediately. We had a decision, remember, it was about a certain issue. about putting taxes on a certain product, and then they reversed it, you see. Things of that sort, you see, governmental decisions which are not taken in a professional manner, still, this causes a lot of turbulence and uncertainty. Mm. And an investor cannot come into a country living in a turbulent and uncertain environment. You see, if you want hot money coming in and out, that's the stock market, you see, and that's not investment. And then again, I'd like to point out that when people are very happy when the stock market goes up, they think that the economy is, this doesn't relate to the economy at all. It relates to money, which is coming in and out to make short-term gains in the for certain people. Mm. On the other side,
but the stock market is not intended for short-term. People misuse it. This is another
function. It is used.
But it's not short-term investment.
It's not short-term, but actually now it's used like that. However, again, if you want a long-term investment, you have to have stability. You have to have clearance of the law, you see. You have to have trust, you see. I think there's a degree of mistrust between the administration and the government and the citizens, because they don't, since 6 years we've been saying that we're improving and we're doing this and that and that, and after 2 years we're very good, you see.
Point
and
understood.
Nothing happened.
Point understood.
You see, so.
You have 1 minute because we need to wrap.
I think we don't know what do we require from the foreign investor. We don't have a program. If a foreign investor comes with his money, what do we need in Egypt? The Minister of Industry, the Minister of Agriculture, both of them should have an agenda. What do we need from a foreign investor to grow in Egypt?
The government presented a program for approval from in the parliament. So this program did not have.
I'm not talking about a program. I'm talking about a list and detailed industries. What do we miss in our structure? What do we import from foreign companies? I don't want to say names in particular, what can we produce in Egypt and what do we require? Japan, we could have actually had a joint huge company with Japan and actually create the overseas fishing Egyptian-Japanese fleet and go and fish with them and feed the Egyptians. Do we require food? We require food and we require fish. Why don't we just cooperate with successful partners and invest with them? We have the manpower. Train them, and let's get the right equipment and let's go in the right places and fish with successful partners.
Yes,
we need to actually be creative and have a good vision, healthy vision. What do we require? We don't really know what do we require, unfortunately, till today.
Okay, gentlemen, I'd like to thank you both for your fruitful input, and we'll continue our discussion. The two revolutions definitely had a psychological impact on the Egyptian person. We'll be discussing this right after the short break, so please stay with us. Welcome back. We're joined in the studio with Dr. Saeed Abdelazim, professor of psychiatry at Cairo University. A pleasure to have you with us. Over the past few years, the Egyptian person has changed. Some things have been positive, others, unfortunately, we cannot say so positive. But if I was to ask you to analyze how the evolving of the change or how the Egyptian person changed over the past few years, especially the younger generation, because the younger you are, the more susceptible you are to change and influence by your environment. At least this is what I think, and it's up to you to say.
The younger generation. I think all Egyptians pass a hard time, about 5 to 6 years now, from 11 to 11 up till now, and we are accustomed to pass such things. Egyptians were famous of that very long ago. And I think the River Nile imposed something on us as Egyptians, because thousands of years we passed very hard time when we have no flood. And Egypt was devoid of even food.
So we've been through hard cycles. Yes. Egyptians are used to the hard cycles.
So we are used to that. It is not new for us.
Yes.
This is number one. And number two, Egyptians are have a quality of being patient. They are patient. They can suffer without complaining even sometimes for long times. But everybody has a limit for that.
Definitely.
But Egyptians can do something like that. They can carry heavy weights along.
For prolonged time.
Oh, yes.
How do you think we changed? Did we change?
No, I think we didn't change. It is the human being characters. We suffered. And this suffering is, it has a result. And the result, we sometimes have less money, we have less food, we have confusion about what is going on. We have hard time as well as regards how to protect ourselves. And we were met with thieves, were very, very odd people who were despaired in Egypt, and we are surrounded by many, many people around us who are, their will and their plan is to make us surrender.
If I were to ask you, because one of the dangers that we face is the energy, the youth energy, and if it's misused, it can be very destructive. You have, Egypt has a large percentage of its population are the young population. They're very energetic, they have a lot of energy, and they want things to be done quickly. And now they reached a stage whereby they are restless. And this restless phase, if we don't use it properly, it can be very destructive.
Sure.
How can we reach a stage where this is, we mobilize this energy, we contain this energy in a useful or in a positive fashion?
We should do many things. And the first thing is how to make use of this energy. They have energy. And the usual path of our education, I think up till now, is not in the correct way. All people are going to sit on chairs, and we hate, many of the young generations may hate the doing a work but with their hands, not with their minds only. And now this type of learning is deficient, still deficient, and not properly done. And I think we need the help of countries like Germany, like Japan. They have a lot of experience about this type of learning, how to do this learning for the majority of those restless young generation. Mm. And when you are restless and you do something with your hands, you can get more quiet and you can do something beneficial, and you can make the economy much better. Mm-hmm. And I think this is the now, this is the thought now, how to do this. Because we are surrounded by many things pressing on us, the political and the military opposition all around us. All this makes us not concentrating mainly on the economy, or how to raise the economy. We did many things good up to now, but to make us more productive, to make our industrial our factories more able to export good things with a good quality, maybe to Africa, maybe to Asia, Europe. This needs not the help. We need the cooperation, and I think this can be done within the political scene.
Since you're here, and here we're going to talk about the psychiatry of the Egyptian person, one of the issues that we faced since the January 25th revolution, and maybe it increased after the July, the June 30th, and that is the terrorism.
Nice.
And one of the things that is quite mind-boggling, how can a young person reach a stage whereby he is brainwashed to the extent where he feels that he goes into a plate, he detonates himself, basically he kills himself,
sure,
kills others in the name of God. How can we protect...
A form of suicide.
It is a suicide. Mm-hmm. It is a suicide.
Yeah.
In reality, it's a suicide. Unfortunately, they don't see it this way. How can we work on those brains that have been manipulated to do such terrorist activities? And I think that these people that do this, like the young man that killed himself in the St. Peter's Church, he victimized a lot of people, but he himself is a victim of a wrong ideology.
Yeah.
How can we change the mindset of those
people? We should start early with the younger generation when they are in the primary school, secondary school, etc. And they were, unfortunately, exposed to those who are permeating the ground, working wrongly with the religion and make the religion like that. We should mix it with politics. This is a wrong society. This is a wrong population. They are not good Muslims. They play on that very early. And they play on the poverty of many of these persons. They are under the moderate quality of life, which gives them place to live in, the proper education, how to cover their needs. Sometimes these are deficient, and they play on that, not only on the ideology, but on the poverty and on the weakness.
Young people, well, you need to revamp the educational system and the religious discourse, proper education of religion and what have you. But for someone who is late, a teenager, I'm talking about 18, 19, or in their 20s.
Or even before.
I'm talking about that age, where they're not no longer in the school age, but maybe university students or graduates. Is it too late to change this mindset?
Sometimes it is difficult when they reach that age.
I'm talking about that, because this is that age that actually killed themselves.
Yes, because they passed a long time before this 18. 19, they became under the mastery of those people from the age of 10 or even before. And they go like that sneaky way to their families, give them help, give them sugar, give them oil. Give this is the track and the way.
Can we change the mindset of those people?
We should begin with the families, with the very early young generation. But those who are spoiled already, those who
can we
are,
do, what can we do about this? Because these are the bombs right now.
Yes,
I mean,
yes.
These are really the walking bombs, and these are the ones that commit those acts. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we found that it is difficult. And we have a long experience since the era of Nasser and Sadat, and after that, about how we can change their thinking, this stubborn thinking, and this way of mixing religion with erratic ideas. So, and many of them relapsed back again, even after this effort, which was done to them in prisons. They started in prisons. They were kept in prisons, and El Mufti and others went and discussed with them.
Do you also, I mean, when you say the Mufti or the sheikhs would talk to them from a religious perspective,
yes,
but do they also need psychiatrists to talk to them
Do
they need counseling?
Yes, they need counseling, but sometimes even it is fruitless because they are like the amalgam. Because they started very early and for years. It's not one day or 2 days or a lecture or no, years. And the mixing between economy and ideology. Economy and ideology. We are giving you money, we are giving you food, and we are giving you ideas. We are brothers.
Yes. One of the other problems is depression. Unfortunately, due to a number of facts. I mean, Egypt is in a state of war with terrorism, for example.
Yes.
We are in economic war. I mean, countries are doing their best to really deprive you of a lot of your main sources of income, tourism, for example, so forth and so on. This is reflecting negatively on some Egyptians to the point that you find a lot of people saying, we're depressed. And this is the worst thing that can happen, because if you reach the, I mean, this is really, it wipes out any positive energy within you to work and to build, especially the young people. Because, as I was saying, they're more, they're easily influenced. What can we do, or what advice would you give the people not to give in at difficult times? And mind you, for example, when I talk to my parents, they say, well, we've been through the 56 war, we've been through the 73 war, we've been through that. My generation and the younger generations, there are certain cycles in history where we did not live it personally. So to us, it's quite shocking, for example, to hear guns and to hear to see military tanks in your backyard and what have you. We were exposed over the past two revolutions to things which we did not live in before.
Sure.
The majority of the Egyptians are in that young generation group. How can they not succumb to depression?
First, we should notify that it is not in terminology depression. We can say low spirit. We can say reaction with sadness, with the negative atmosphere surrounding us. It is not really depression.
Okay.
Because depression, in its proper terminology, is a sickness and illness.
Okay.
And it can have an crescendo, going up every day, up to that we are going not to willing to live. We hate life. We need to die.
Okay.
We can suicide. So this is depression, mounting. But reaction for something not good, or for something pressing on us, is a time in relation to the time. And after that, if the things are improved, we are going to improve immediately. So it is not depression in the proper terminology.
Okay.
So if we are going to help people, we should give them support. People need support, either economic, either emotional, either clarification, good information. We should not leave them like that, confused. Because confusion by like we see on the Facebook and WhatsApp and so on, so many rumors are surrounding us. and all the rumors are giving negative energy, really. Everything is bad. Everything is not okay. We are going to so-and-so. We are losing so-and-so. So people hearing all the time negative things. And sometimes they believe in it.
Mm.
And it is really a dangerous situation.
Mm.
They use it like that, like guns. It is really guns.
Okay.
Yes. So this is the bad thing we are facing now. And this is the real way to lose the spirits and to lose the energy by always facing negative things.
Mm.
The rebound from the government, from the institutions, from every able persons, they can give the reverse. They can give the real facts. We are now doing so and so. The economy is going to improve by what? And
some positive information,
yeah,
positive to give hope.
And real.
Yeah, it definitely has to be, but has
give them
some facts and figures whereby people feel that we're moving.
Yes.
Dr. Saeed Abdelazim, unfortunately, our time is up. Thank you very much for your fruitful input. I'd like to thank you, the viewers, and tomorrow another day and another debate, and good night.